Hello everybody, I'm Angelique Caring with the NASA Langley Digital Team, and we're here at the Langley Launch Lounge. Today we're going to be talking all things LOFTID, the science, the data, the launch. Would you two lovely individuals mind introducing yourselves so that everybody can meet you?
All right, I'm Anjie Emmet. I've been here at NASA Langley since 2007, and I've been working on LOFTID since about 2017. And I've been working as an aerospace engineer.
My name is Hillary Blakeley. I've been at Langley since 2013 and working LOFTID as well since about 2017. Also generally employed by NASA as an aerospace engineer, but for LOFTID, I've been working as the inflation system lead.
All right, so I've got this little list of questions here.
Great.
First and foremost is my favorite question of all time, which is, what is your favorite part of the job?
So one of the things that I've always loved, regardless of what project, is, in a weird way, any day that we do testing. At that point, you've usually designed and seen your models on a computer, and you finally have gotten them in your hands, you've built them, and now it's time to put the proof to the pudding and see if it works. And this is why we test, because often it doesn't. And so it's usually a day filled with chaos and challenges, but at the same time, a day filled with people coming together, doing what NASA does best, doing the impossible, and figuring out how to make it happen at the end of the day. Being the inflation system lead, I work with a lot of flowing nitrogen, so usually my tests create a lot of noise and even more chaos for all those around. So those are usually my favorite parts of the job.
Flowing nitrogen.
Yes, so LOFTID itself being an inflatable heat shield, it's inflated with nitrogen. So my role as the inflation system lead has been to kind of analyze, design, build, and lead the system that gets that nitrogen from our stored containers into the aeroshell in a way that is safe and controlled within our trajectory timeline, and in such a way that doesn't explode our inflatable heat shield. That would be a very bad day.
Yeah, exploding is generally not how we want things to go.
No, we inflate, we don't blow up.
And what about you, Andy?
I think testing is absolutely one of the highlights, because there's almost this endorphin rush that you get when you test and it goes well. And that's the same with the whole assembly, integration, and testing portion of it. When things go together and they go together correctly and smoothing, that's also just a huge endorphin rush and just such a sense of accomplishment.
What do you think is the aspect, I suppose, with the test that has been the most important for you, like the one that you've been like, okay, like that's kind of like my jam, or are you kind of involved in the whole thing?
I would say for me personally, I've been more involved in the structures testing, making sure things fit, like the fit checks, making sure that when you vibrate them, you know, during the vibration testing, that everything stays,
doesn't fall apart.
I've actually always wondered about vibration testing. So is it like literally it goes into just something that kind of shakes it up?
That is really, it goes on a big table, yeah. A big table, and it vibrates in different directions.
Okay.
It shakes, and it shakes so fast that if you're watching it, especially on a TV screen, you don't even realize it's shaking. It just looks like it's standing still because it's just so fast.
How long has everything been in testing, I guess?
I would say from fall of 2019, and probably samples of the aerosol were being tested before then, even.
Yeah.
Up to, I mean, we'll run final testing 2 weeks ago. It's probably last testing, and we have a few procedures that we'll do as we go to approach final integration with our spacecraft before we launch on November 1st.
Woo!
Makes my heart flutter just thinking about it.
I know. How did it feel once it got to October and you realized, oh, we're really 1 month away?
Well, I have one more trip. I've been lucky enough that being with the inflation system, that is something that we take a lot of care. We take a lot of care with everything, but because my system contains two very large composite over at pressure vessels, each filled with 3,000 psi of nitrogen, you want to make sure that's safe and everything's functioning as it's supposed to be. So when we delivered the payload out to Vandenberg Space Force Base in California, that was one of the first things that we tested with, okay, does everything, all the instrumentation still read normal? Do we still have the pressure that we think we do in the tanks? Does everything still flow as expected? So I've been able to go back and forth between Vandenberg and Langley, working all of that. And I have one more trip actually next week to do our final top off to make sure that we are at a maximum pressure for launch, that we have everything optimum ready for the flight mission. So once I realized it was my last trip out there, and then I'll be headed, getting ready for launch, oh my goodness, at the end of this month, like almost gives me the jitter, something you just worked on and poured your heart and your soul and your life into for so many years. And a technology we both have become really invested in. It's really rewarding.
One of the big exciting aspects of this, so we are testing, we are proving this concept out, and we are testing this brand new technology. And we've had smaller tests of this before. On a sounding, yes, going up on a sounding rocket, making sure it inflates. This one, it's going to complete an orbit around the Earth, and it's going to go through a trajectory that's really going to give us really good data about this system and about its applicability in the future. And I think it's really neat because this is a big aeroshell.
Yeah.
It's big. It's 6 meters.
6 meters. How would you, like, if you were going to say, like, it's around the size of a...
I've thought about this because it's bigger than a minivan.
So 6 meters is about 20 feet.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's
we'll
a really
go
good
with
analogy.
That.
And for you, Hillary, what makes it all super exciting?
This is just such an exciting enabling technology for both NASA and commercial entities. So yes, LOFTID is a technology demonstration of how we can scale up this technology. Hopefully, being the leading technology to get humans to Mars, for that we would need about an 18-meter size heat shield, so more than doubling what we have now. But we have a lot more smaller range applications as well. So you can use this heat shield anywhere that has an atmosphere. That means you can use it coming back down into Earth. So if we wanted something smaller, say we wanted to better enable space systems, the ISS, down mass type missions, medical missions, something that they want to get back from the space station, but they don't want to have to create a cargo return for. Well, if you have an inflatable heat shield, something that dramatically reduces size and weight, but when it reenters, dramatically increases size. So you can regain a lot of heavier payloads coming back into Earth's orbit. We have applications like our partnership right now for LOFTID is with United Launch Alliance, ULA. Mm-hmm. With the intent of being able to use a HIAD to recover their first stage engines. So then you get cheaper to space options with being able to reuse launch vehicles. So there's both big scale, big dream items such as Mars and smaller scale return to Earth, practical, you know, uses of tomorrow options. And it's just a fascinating technology having both of those available.
I love that as a term, just uses of tomorrow.
Yeah. That is a good one.
That's really cool. Okay, and I'm glad you said so 18 meters is what this would need to get to for us to go to Mars.
Yes, humans to Mars.
Okay, so three times what we've got now.
Just about.
Okay, so many, many, many vans.
Many, many vans. And I mean, we need to scale up for a lot of the missions. So for a lot of the launch vehicle return missions, that would be about 10 to 12 meters. So the 6 meter is really a good proving point. We'll use probably a lot of the same technology, a lot of the same development fabrication methods of the aeroshell itself as we go to develop these larger heat shields.
At 6 meters, it's very heavy. It's like 400 pounds for just the aeroshell. So just the sheer mass and handling this soft good when it's not inflated, it's delicate enough that you have to handle it somewhat carefully, but then it has the silicon carbide fibers, so you have to be careful with your skin and touching it.
Okay.
So yeah, just the logistics of having a larger aeroshell to pack and to work with, that'll be something that we'll work forward to.
That actually brings up quite a few questions that I have, and I think probably a lot of people have, right? It looks like it's a bunch of inner tubes stacked on top of each other. It's not. I know that.
Good job.
Nice. What is it made out of?
So, you're right. That's exactly what it looks like. In a less glorified way, that's exactly what it is. However, instead of kind of your pool inner tubes that you use as a kid when it's made out of plastic, it's made out of a stack of seven. We call them tori. A singular is torus. The stack of seven is the tori. And those are made out of a woven Kevlar fabric that, when inflated, it's 15 times stronger than steel. So it's not your plastic that you're using in the pool. So that inflatable structure itself, once you get all seven of them, once it's inflated, becomes a very firm aeroshell. And that's what actually helps it keep its shape against the drag forces as you're re-entering the atmosphere.
Okay.
Now, over top of that, because that by itself is not going to give you any heat protection,
yeah,
but it is going to help you keep structure and create the drag. So you have to have your heat protection system over top of it.
Okay.
And this is one of the really interesting parts about HAYA technology. It's a flexible thermal protection system, FTPS, that we use. And you're limited a lot in historical heat shields by being built out of metallics or ceramics that can only be as large as your rocket shroud.
Mm-hmm.
Well, getting that inflatable aeroshell and the FTPS over top of it allows you to compact really, really small because it is, as Angie mentioned, a woven soft good. And that FTPS is made up of a bunch of different layers. The top one is kind of silicon carbide that helps keep the integrity of the surface of the aeroshell. Then underneath you have numerous woven layers and gas barriers to help prevent any heat transfer into the inflatable structure, because that inflatable structure is not going to take the heat by itself. And then by the time you're in the payload, by the time you have everyone behind that inflatable structure, they're good to go.
That's impressive. Okay, so like a bulletproof inner tube.
I don't know if they've actually tried hitting it with a bullet, but I wouldn't put it past them. You've got a lot of crazy engineers and researchers on this project.
All right, so whether you're going to be in California or Hawaii or Hampton, wherever you will be, you can watch along on NASA TV live for the launch on November 1st. We can't wait, and we hope to see you there.